Good morning. Happy Resurrection Sunday. Amen. Woo! Let's stand. Let's sing. Oh, happy day.
This beat him, you have rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. The empty cross, the empty grave, life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. You are mine. Endless joy, perfect peace. Earthly pain finally will cease. Celebrate, Jesus is alive.
You're going to be singing that all day today. Listen, we're so glad you're here today. Many people have been praying for this event, praying for you. We're glad you're here. I'm excited about it. I mean, what a great message. He has risen. He has risen indeed. Come on. We and hundreds of thousands of churches from around the nation, around the world, this is what we're celebrating, this fact, this truth, that on the third day, the stone was rolled away. Again, not to let Jesus out, but to let you and I in, to witness and to see it. So we're going to be praying for you. So it's only fitting. You know what? Let me ask you, how many of you, this is your first time, this is your first Easter with us. Can I see your hands? Wow, look at, let's welcome them. We're glad you're here. I'm just going to begin our service. We have a great service prepared for you. It's just going to be incredible music and great message. So we're just going to begin by praying. Father in heaven, Lord, we just thank you so much. We thank you for your love for us. We thank you for the message of Easter, that you're alive. You're alive. Death could not hold you. Sin could not keep you. But you resurrected just as you said you were. And so, Father, we pray. I pray. I know many, many are believers in this place today. You've changed our lives forever. But I know there's some here. Maybe it's in their head, but it hasn't gone into their heart. Lord, our prayer today is that this message will just speak to them personally. See, that's the truth. You're the God. You're the personal God. You're not this God of religion. You're not this God that seems so separate, so far away, but you're so near. And so my prayer, our prayer, is that you would touch hearts. Lord, as we were singing, we'll never be the same again. We will never be the same. Lord, bless every person here. Bless every child. Bless every family. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Why don't you stand up and greet one another? Say hi to each other.
You
Celebrate. I was thinking, I'm just letting you know, in case you haven't figured it out, it's going to be a little loud, but I was thinking, you know, when they crossed the Red Sea and the horse and rider were thrown into the sea, I don't think they were quiet when they were celebrating. It was noisy, right? Those walls of Jericho came down. Was it quiet? No. When Jesus came into Jerusalem on that colt, was it quiet? No. And he rose again. We're not going to be quiet. So let's just go for it. I'd like to invite you, if you're comfortable, you want to come down here and join us? Please feel free. You ready? Let's do it. Amen.
I was lost with a broken heart. You picked me up, now I'm set apart. The ash, I am born again, forever safe in the Savior's hands. You are more than my words could say. I'll follow you, Lord, for all my days. It's my eyes following your ways, forever free in unending grace. 'Cause you are, my freedom. We lift you higher, lift you higher.
Oh,
Lord. Praise the Lord. Just to give you an opportunity to rest a bit, please see it for our next song. You may want to stand halfway through it, but we'll give you a rest. Praise the Lord. The risen one has overcome. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Spirit, I will rise from the ashes of defeat.
Lord. Will you all stand? We'll sing this last song together. I think a lot of you will recognize it. Our hope. Amen. Our hope. Hallelujah.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. You're my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, declared the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your very body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me.
dear Lord, we praise you, we thank you, we bless your name. In Jesus' name, amen. Have a seat.
Seated. Listen, someone just asked me, they said, Bob, how do you follow that? Well, I'll tell you how you follow that. Turn in your Bibles, if you have your Bibles with you, to John's Gospel, chapter 20. And before us there is that first Easter morning account, and it's not joyous. It's not victorious. It's actually dark and troubling. In fact, the scene opens there in verse 1. Now, the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb early while it was still dark and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. And then she ran and came to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved and said to them, they, whoever they are, have taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him. One of the things as I look over all these events, I look over all the Gospels, is there wasn't a lot of faith that first Easter morning. There wasn't a lot of faith that third day after Christ's crucifixion. This small band of followers, they're reeling. They're just so lost. After seeing their Savior, the Messiah, the one who they thought was the one who was going to bring destruction to their enemies and bring them and raise them up, but he was crucified. They saw that. He was taken and killed, and it looked bleak. It looked finished. Yet the account that I chose this year, John's Gospel, he writes this Gospel 60 years later after this event. He's rethinking these things. He's looking at these things. And it's interesting in the text, if you have in your Bibles, you could see it on the screen. There in verse 9, it says, for as yet they did not know the scripture that he, Jesus, must rise again from the dead. And I find that so interesting for this flock, for these people who walked with Jesus for 3.5 years. They didn't know the scriptures. It's interesting when you just take a quick look and you look at many of those Old Testament scriptures, Psalm 16, Psalm 22, Daniel chapter 9, Hosea 6, Isaiah 53. I could rattle off verses and texts that speak about this glorious rising, this supernatural event. But sadly, they missed it. And John is telling us here the reason why, he's writing to Christians, to believers, the reason why they missed it, they didn't know the scriptures. In fact, many of you, you're familiar with that text in Luke 24, and there's two discouraged disciples. They're walking with Jesus. They don't know they're walking with Jesus. And they're all bummed out about what happened and what had taken place. And they're telling Jesus about this event and about this one who they thought was the Messiah had now died. Jesus said to those two discouraged disciples there, he says, you foolish people, you find it so hard to believe all that the prophets wrote in the scriptures. Listen to what he says. He says, wasn't it clearly predicted that the Messiah would have to suffer all these things before entering his glory? And then Jesus took them through the writings of Moses and all the prophets, explaining from all the scriptures the things concerning himself. I would love to hear that Bible study. But he spoke of these things and testified to them about his coming, about his rising, all these things, all these events. But he tells them they were slow of heart to believe, despite all the facts that they had. All the things that they had seen, just think about it. They had witnessed three resurrections, three people that were literally raised from the dead. They had seen the many signs and wonders. Plus, many times Jesus had said in their company, he said to those religious leaders, those critics, he said, you destroy this temple, pointing to himself, he said, in 3 days I will raise it up. In another place, he says, just as Jonah the prophet was 3 days in the belly of the fish, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the belly of the earth. They heard these statements, but they missed it. Listen, the resurrection of Jesus Christ is the most studied, most examined historical event in all of history. There's no denying it. Every year I take this time and I begin to look over these things in these papers. In fact, there's one authority. I love this guy. His name's Simon Greenleaf, professor of Harvard Law, writer of a 3-volume treatise on collecting evidence. They still use it today. He says this, I quote, "There is more evidence for the historical fact of the resurrection of Jesus Christ than for just about any other event in history." End of quote. It's real. And listen, it changes lives. And this message of the resurrection can change your life today. Your life can be changed today. This account is a fact, and the person who stands out to me the most that first Easter was the one we read there in verse 1 of John's Gospel, Mary Magdalene. And we read of this woman here, how she rises up early. She actually goes the fourth watch, it says. It was between 3 and 6 o'clock in the morning. John even points out, it's still dark. In chapter 19, just the chapter before it, it says that she was there. As Jesus is being crucified, she was there with the mother of Jesus and also John, the disciple. She's mentioned 14 times in the New Testament. 9 of those times, she's always mentioned first. It's only in chapter 19 where Mary is mentioned first because Jesus is speaking to Mary. But this woman, this testimony we have of Mary, she plays a an important point in Jesus' ministry. Now, there's been a lot of terrible movies made about her, you know, in the past. And I'm just talking just, you know, from the Da Vinci Codes to the one they just recently made. I'm telling you right now, don't even go and see it. Don't even bother. It got 45 Rotten Tomatoes, so it's bad. But Mary has a powerful testimony of what Jesus can do in the life of anybody. In fact, Mark, in his gospel, he opens up this account there in chapter 16, verse 1, saying this. "Now, when he rose early that first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he had cast out 7 demons." This was Mary before she encountered Christ. Now, imagine that. 7 demons. I can't even imagine 1 demon. But every day her life was a nightmare, never to end, controlled by these influences, tormented by them, depressed by them. We're not sure how this happened. There's many suggestions that, you know, before Mary's life, before she came to Christ, you know, something happened. There's many that say to, you know, that she was a prostitute. And, you know, and I don't believe that's true. The reason why the scholars come up with that is because she was from the town of Magdala. And Magdala was known for its brothels and harlotry. But I want to throw something out to you. What I love about the New Testament never, in all the chapters there, it never mentions those mentioned in sin. The Holy Spirit never mentions those people. You think of the woman caught in the act of adultery. Her name is never mentioned. The woman at the well who was married 4 or 5 times and she was actually living with somebody. But yet she encountered Jesus Christ. But just think of Mary. You know, it's interesting. The word Magdala, it means strong tower or fortress. And those demonic spirits that influenced Mary controlled her. They had become a fortress to her, controlling her thoughts, controlling how she felt, never letting up, overwhelming her. I say this because this may speak to you here today. You're here on this Easter morning, but you're tormented. You're depressed. You're filled with anxiety. Every day of your life, it's the same thing. It's the same thing that's before you. And you've been to doctors. You've been to psychiatrists. Maybe you even been to pastors, you've been to priests, and it seems like nobody has an answer for you. Nobody can help you. But the reason why I chose this account is because this account testifies of one who can deliver you from whatever you're going through, whatever your darkness is right now. There is one who can set you free, and his name is Jesus Christ. He can turn your darkness into light. He can turn your fortress into hope. All it says in Luke's gospel is that one day she encountered Jesus. One day. That's all it took was one day, one encounter to Jesus, and she was changed forever. And I want you to know why is because he's God. He is the Son of God. He is everything the scriptures testify of him. In fact, Paul, he was writing to the Roman church there in Romans 1:4. He says this of Jesus. He is declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection of the dead. Listen, Jesus Christ resurrects the dead. Jesus Christ can raise anything. He can raise the addict. He can raise the person, the people who feel like life has given up on them. He can raise you up. In fact, I want you to know he is here in this place right now. He's here. He's among us. And now this Mary who has been touched by Christ, encountered Christ, she wanted one more touch, one more glimpse of the one who saved her completely and took away her fears. She wanted one more touch. But now he's gone. His body was gone. So verse 2 says this. Then she ran and came to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved and said to them, they have taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they had laid him. And Peter therefore went out, and the other disciple, this is John, and were going to the tomb, and they both ran together. The other disciple outran Peter and came to the tomb first. Whenever I read that, I always get a chuckle out of that. Here's Peter writing, John is writing this gospel 60 years later, and he wants every one of you guys to know, I beat Peter to the tomb. I outran him. You know, some competitions, they never end. But what I also want you to see here is, they left Mary in the dust. I mean, these guys are supposed to be apostles. These are the gentlemen. I mean, they just leave her there. They're off to the tomb. Now, John in these next four verses here explains to us a process of realization. And I want you to look at this. That he and Peter came across that first Easter morning. He says there in verse 5, and he, stooping down and looking in, saw the linen cloths lying there, yet he did not go in. Now, for whatever reason, John doesn't run in. He gets there first, but he stays outside. And there could have been many reasons why he stayed outside. I mean, you know, being a religious Jew, he didn't want to be, you know, religiously or ceremonially unclean. I can understand that. I can also understand just 2 days before, John was there at the crucifixion. He saw this one whom he loved beaten beyond recognition. But notice what it says there in verse 5. John uses this Greek word here for saw. And it means in the Greek here, this word here, it means to only glance or to peek in quickly. He's looking outside, and I've been to the tomb. And I want you to know it's empty. I've been there twice to Israel. And I've been to this tomb, and there is somewhat of a way of getting into it and looking in there. And he just glanced quickly at the linen cloth just lying there. But look at verse 6. You got to love Simon Peter. It says, then Simon Peter came following him, and he went into the tomb, and he saw, but it's a different saw, the linen cloth lying there, and the handkerchief that had been around his head, not lying with the linen cloth, but folded together in place by itself. So Peter here, true to form, I mean, he just dives right into the tomb, you know, impetuous and spontaneous. But it says he sees, and that word see or saw there, It's where we get our, you know, we get our English word theater from, or theory. It's the word theorin. He theored in. And it means to look closely. It means to look intently at. And Peter's mind's racing here. You know, he sees, according to all four Gospels, the linen that were used to wrap Jesus. According to Hebrew practice, they would wrap the body. They would basically, like a mummy, they would wrap this body, and In fact, in chapter 19, verse 39, it tells us there that Nicodemus and also Joseph of Arimathea, that day they were given permission to take the body of Jesus, to wrap it, to cleanse it, and they would wrap it. And it says he used 100 pounds of myrrh. Now this guy had to be a rich guy. Number one, it's his grave that they're putting Jesus in. Yet you had to have some money back then. And 100 pounds of myrrh, I mean, this is overkill here. Basically, as they would wrap the bandages around, they would put this myrrh. It was a gum-like substance. And what it was to do, it was to hold the bandages in place, but it was also to remove any kind of smell. So you got to understand the picture. This is why the Gospels are pointing this out. As Peter is looking and observing at this scene, he sees this mummy-like shape. It's like a cocoon. There's no body there. The bandages are all in place, but it's hollow. And he's thinking to himself, how could this happen? If you're going to take the body, you're going to take the whole body, wrappings and all. You're not going to leave. And if you did leave the wrappings to take the body, you would find them all over the place. But instead, they're untouched. In fact, verse 7 says, the handkerchief that had been around his head, not lying with the linen cloths, but folded together in place by itself. Even the cloth that was on his head, instead of being thrown to the side, it's folded. And Peter's wondering here, how could this be? And I'm probably thinking, he's beginning to remember the words of Jesus. He's beginning to remember the things that Jesus said. Maybe he did rise. Maybe he did. And you know, there's when I think of that scene, when I think of Peter, Peter's like many people, they failed the Lord. Peter failed the Lord big time. In fact, when Jesus was telling the disciples, all of them were going to forsake him, all of them were going to leave him, Peter said in front of all the guys, he said, Jesus, they're all going to flake out, but not me. I'm Rocky. I'm going to stay by your side. I'll never deny you. And Jesus said to him, sadly, Peter, not once but three times, you're going to deny ever knowing me. And that scene, there's a scene that Luke gives us in Luke 22, 61. I want to read to you. I always remember this scene. As Jesus is coming out of that interrogation, as Peter, let me read it to you. It says, at that moment, the Lord turned and looked at Peter as he's denying him for the third time. And the Lord's words flashed through Peter's mind, before the rooster crows tomorrow morning, you will deny three times that you even know me. And Peter left the courtyard weeping bitterly. You talk about being busted. You talk about being caught in your sin. This was Peter. He's broken. He's finished spiritually. See, what I want you to see here from these accounts and what I believe the Spirit of God wants you and I to see here, that first Easter morning, there wasn't a lot of faith around that empty tomb. There weren't faithful people. There weren't sinless people that were there. But instead, doubters, fallen people, broken people, hopeless people, grieving people. And like John in verse 5, you know, I was thinking, you know, as he just glances in, some of you, you'll come Resurrection Sunday, or maybe you'll come to Christmas, and you come in a little bit closer every time. But you still, it's just this peek, it's just this look. And you come, and I'm glad that you come. But you're not drawn in, you're not coming in completely. But then there's many of you here today. And I know you're here today. And you're broken spiritually. You feel separated from God. You're going through things in your life right now that are just weighing on you, your marriage, your child, and these things are just overwhelming you. And you heard from the Bible that Jesus Christ is the friend of sinners. You heard that he's the great shepherd that would leave the 99 for that one lost sheep. And you're looking, and you're seeking, and you're taking these things in. See, I'm going to break it right to it. There in verse 8, it says there, then the other disciple, speaking of John, who came to the tomb first, went in also. But it says there, he saw and he believed. It's, again, a different word. It means he saw. It means he perceived. He understood. He realized. The light bulbs went on in his head. Jesus Christ has risen from the dead. That's the place we all need to get to. See, what does this mean? What does it mean that Jesus rose from the grave? I'm telling you what it means. It means everything Jesus ever said is true. When Jesus made that statement in John chapter 5, 24, look what he says. I tell you the truth, those who listen to my message and believe in God who sent me have eternal life. They will never be condemned for their sins, but they have already passed from death to life. What does it mean? It means we will never die. Jesus said outside a funeral where he was about to raise Lazarus from the grave, he said these words, I am the resurrection and the life. Anyone who believes in me will live even after dying. Everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. I love it. It's all true. We're never going to die. He gives us eternal life. He never lies to us. In fact, Jesus, just this night, before he's going to be crucified, he gets the tone. He realizes his disciples are nervous. His disciples are fearful. And Jesus says to them there in John 14, 1, don't let your hearts be troubled. You trust in God. Trust also in me. Listen to this. There is more than enough room in my Father's home. He's speaking of heaven here. If it were not so, I would have told you that I am going to prepare a place for you, and when everything is ready, I will come and get you so that you will always be with me where I am. This is what the resurrection means. But closing, look at verse 10. It says, then the disciples went away again in their own homes, but Mary stood outside by the tomb weeping, and she wept, and she stooped down and looked into the tomb. Again, as we look at that scene, the disciples, again, there's a process going on in their heads, but they leave Mary flat. And it says here she's crying, and the Greek would render it, she's literally sobbing at this point. It's uncontrollably, it's constant. In fact, that's what the sting of death does, doesn't it? Death is so final. I've been there. I've been at the bedside of many people and watched them pass. And you could just see it. It's gone. They're not in that body anymore. And it seems so final. It seems so eternal. Verse 12 says, and she saw two angels in white sitting, one on the head and the other on the feet, where the body of Jesus had laid. And then they said to her, woman, why are you weeping? That's a dangerous question, right, guys? You never want to answer that question. You never want to say that. Only angels can get away with this. But she said to them, because they have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him. You know what I find so interesting at this scene here? Not even angels draws Mary's attention. It's interesting when you study this scene, this first resurrection morning, that there were angels all over the place. People were moved. People were like... In fact, I'll just read one. In fact, it's one of my favorite encounters on the resurrection. It's Matthew 28, 2. Listen to what it says. Suddenly there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven, rolled aside the stone, and sat on it. Can you picture that? His face shone like lightning, and his clothing were as white as snow. The guards shook with fear when they saw him, and they fell into a dead faint. Then the angel spoke to the woman. Don't be afraid, he said. I know you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen from the dead just as he said it would happen. Come see where the body was laying. Again, angels there. But you know what? I want you to know here. Once you encounter the risen Christ, once you encounter Jesus Christ, you are never the same again. Not even angels can touch you. In fact, I love this quote. R.W. Dale, one Easter morning, he gets up and it just makes sense to him, this whole resurrection. He says, a living Christ is an all-powerful Christ. A living Christ is a present Christ. A living Christ is a Christ who gives us life now. A living Christ is one who gives us eternity. A living Christ is a Christ who gives us victory. This is who this Christ is. This is what he does. But it's interesting, this scene, as Mary's coming in, it says one angel is on the foot where Jesus was and one is on the head. And those of you who are Christian, those of you who are familiar with this scene, in Exodus 25, the holiest piece of furniture in all of the Bible is the Ark of the Covenant. And it has a similar picture. It has these two angels that are just, their wings are just touching there. And it says there in the center is the mercy seat. And there God says this, and I want to quote it. Exodus 25, 22. God says to his people there, I will meet with you there and talk to you from above the atonement cover between the gold cherubim that hovers over the Ark of the Covenant. God said, I will speak to you. And you who are being drawn in here today, God is speaking to your heart. And he's speaking to you here from this event. See, Calvary is the reason. Calvary was the reason why Jesus Christ came. Calvary is the reason why Jesus was crucified. Because sin separated us. Our sin separated us from God. Our trespasses separated us from God, where God became distant. But it tells us, Jesus tells us there in John 3:16, for this is how God loved the world. He gave his one and only Son so that everyone who believes in him would not perish but have eternal life. God sent his Son into the world not to judge the world, but to save the world through him. So I want you to know he came to save you. There was a more terrible curse than death. There was a more terrible, than disease or loneliness or depression or anxiety. It was eternal separation from God. It was voidness of his spirit. But Jesus came. Jesus came to make us right with God. Jesus came to make us sons and daughters of God. This is the gospel of Christ. This was the message of Christ. And this was the message Mary was about to learn, that our faith is much more than some building. I'm watching these people. Again, it's a sad picture of what happened over in Notre Dame. But it's not a building. It's not a creed that holds us together. It is the person, Jesus Christ. Verse 14 says this, now when she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there and did not know that it was Jesus. And Jesus said to her, woman, why are you weeping? Who are you seeking? She had no idea he was there. In fact, the literal verse or the grammar would suggest that he was there all along. Jesus was there all along while she was seeking him. What a great question. Whom are you seeking? Who are you seeking today? What are you seeking today? Is it a feeling you're looking for? Is there a presence you're looking for? Maybe you're looking for faith. Maybe you're looking for hope. Maybe you're looking for peace. Maybe you're looking for love. What brings you here today? See, in Mary's case, she was seeking a dead Jesus. Isn't that interesting? One of my commentaries I was looking at, it dawned on me. She drew early in the morning. She kept lingering. She kept seeking after a Jesus that was dead, a body. Even though it says, Jesus says in verse 15, she, supposing him to be the gardener, said to him, sir, if you had carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away. Look at this devotion. This devotion of Jesus. I'm going to be ending real soon, kids. Stop your crying. No. Such devotion. See, I want you to know, she didn't know chapter 20. She didn't know chapter 21. She just loved him. She was devoted to him. See, the truth is, as many of us, we know the rest of the story. We know he'd risen. We know that he was seen by over 500 people in the 40 days after his resurrection. We see Peter preaching his first message just yards away from the empty tomb. 2,000 people get saved. The next week he preaches again. 3,000 people come to faith. And then we read of temple priests coming to faith in Jesus Christ. And the story goes on. What are you seeking here today? Listen, he's here. See, what I love about this scene, where this scene ends, is it says here, he calls her by name. It's too much for Jesus as he's witnessing Mary and he sees how she's overwhelmed. And he says, Mary. And there was something about the way he said Mary. It was personal. See, there were many Marys that followed Jesus. But yet when he said her name, she knew it. In fact, John 10:3 says this, where Jesus said, my sheep recognize my voice and come to me. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. See, this is the truth here today. This Jesus is here right now. I'm going to ask the worship team to come up so you know I'm ending. I always hear that big relief. But listen, Jesus is still speaking today. Think about what Mary experienced when she heard the living Christ call her name. He was alive. He's here. Jesus is here today, and he will remove you from your Magdala. He will remove you from your darkness. He will remove you from your hopelessness, your despair. He'll do that for you today. In fact, Jose is going to close with a great song. It's a great song. And it's called Come to the Altar. And what I'm going to ask you to do, if you hear the Lord's voice speaking to you today, saying, just like I did for Mary, I can do for you. I can bring you out of your darkness. I can bring you out of your despair. I can give you salvation. What is salvation? Salvation is Christ now coming into your heart and changing you. In the song, he's going to sing this, leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes of new life born, Jesus is calling you. So you just get up and you come. And listen, if you brought somebody and they don't want to go up by themselves, you come up with them. Go ahead.
Blood of Jesus Christ.
Listen, I want to encourage you. Maybe you're saying to yourself, well, Bob, this is a private thing. This is a private moment. Why do I have to come forward? I'll tell you why you need to come forward. In Luke chapter 9, verse 26, Jesus said this, if anyone is ashamed of me and my message, the Son of Man will be ashamed of that person when he returns in his glory and the glory of his Father and the holy angels. You know, I always, this time of year, I think of fathers. Many years ago, this is our seventh time doing it, but our first time doing it, there was a father. And his kids didn't know. They didn't know anything about his faith. He was always this private guy. But it was at the event that, to their surprise, they saw their father come up and he came forward and he gave his life to Jesus Christ. And within 3 weeks, he went home to be with the Lord. But his kids know. Do your kids know your faith? Listen, I love the part where it says his arms are open wide. Get rid of the guilt. Get rid of the addiction. Get rid of the bitterness. Get rid of the fear. Why? It's all possible. Jesus Christ. You're not coming to me. You're not coming to this church. You're coming to Jesus Christ. But there's something so powerful when you get up and you come forward and you say, okay, I believe. Today, I believe. Today, I'm coming forward. So you get up. You come forward. Go ahead. Sing it again.
Oh, what a Savior.
Jesus. Oh, what a Savior. Let's sing, pray. Let's
sing. Oh, what a Savior. Isn't he wonderful? Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. Bow down before him. For he is
up this moment. Don't pass it up. I remember hearing a person last year say, I want it to come up. Listen, you come. Saints, what we are witnessing here, this is salvation. This is the greatest miracle, the new birth, where God supernaturally comes down and it's an exchange that takes place. Listen, we take his righteousness. We take his forgiveness. He takes our guilt. He takes our sin. He takes our hell. And we are secure eternal life. So you come. We're going to sing one more time. You sing one more time. We're going to, come. Come forward. Give it to him one more time.
Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was born with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar.
The Bible tells us in Romans 10:9, if you openly declare that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is by believing in your heart that you are made right with God, and it is by openly declaring your faith that you are saved. As the scriptures tell us, anyone who trusts in him will never be disappointed. And then it says, for everyone. I love that, the everyone. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Listen, I want you to know, we're going to say a prayer. We're going to say this prayer together. If you're up there, you say this prayer too. Lord Jesus, I come to you now. I need you. Please forgive me of my sins. I need you to change me. I believe that you are sent from God, that you are God, to save me and give me a new heart. Father in heaven, I thank you so much for what you're doing here today and the lives that are going to be, that our lives are changed forever. And that this is part of the family of God. They are now brought in to your salvation. Can you praise the Lord with me? Thank you, Lord. Hey, listen, we have information. We have Bibles for you. If you guys could go over to this way, we have Bibles for you. And we're gonna close. We got a song we're going to close. Here goes the singer. Go ahead. Close it up. God bless you. We got Bibles for you. You come up. You get them. They're right over here.
Happy Easter.
Happy Easter.